Thank you for joining us today. So today is the second episode of the BWTL, Best Way to Live. And today what I wanted to do is introduce Buddhism as a science. Buddhism is mainly think of as a religion, at best a philosophy. I believe Buddhism is a science. It's a different kind of science, but no less a science, in the sense that I believe modern science, being an engineer scientist myself, science doesn't start with truth, doesn't start with a set of belief that is permanently true. Instead, we start with observations. And for example, whether it's Galileo or Isaac Newton, they start with what they can see, what they can observe, and then they, from that, they come up with a set of postulates. And that set of postulates would explain what they have observed. And we all accept it because it's the best that we have in terms of understanding our surrounding. But at the same time, we understand that someone somewhere will come along and then will come up with a better explanation because they would have better tools, they have better experience in observing our surrounding. And true enough, when Einstein came along 150 years ago, he saw what Isaac Newton did and he said, that's good, but it doesn't explain this. And what he had in mind is the relativity of time. And so he came up with a different set of theory that doesn't necessarily violate what Newton did, but expands it. In other words, it's a more general form of understanding. And if you were to put in some assumptions, and it actually degenerated back into what Newton had done, but it allows him to go to a better understanding of the world. And this is how modern science is built on. It's all built on observation. You observe, you make postulates, and you come up with a set of theory that other people would accept. That gets you in the next part. And sure enough, Einstein, his relativity is now preceded by what a lot of scientists, including Dr. Stephen Hawking, in that relativity explains a lot about how a universe works, but it doesn't explain how the atoms work. And so Stephen Hawking's approach is to unify what is known as relativity and what is known as quantum mechanics. And he came up with what is called, or he and his colleague came up with what is called strength theory, that doesn't violate what Einstein does. It doesn't violate what other scientists have done in quantum mechanics, but unify them and again take them to a different plane. But it's all based on observation. Observation either with our eye or with our mind. Right? You can actually Einstein certainly didn't observe relativity. But he did with his mind. He expands the horizon with his mental power. Buddhism, on the other hand, I believe is also a science. But it's based on, to me, Buddhism as a scientist is based on experience. In other words, what Buddha did was he said, here's how I did it. I took these steps and I slowly and I detach myself from my physical, detach myself from my senses, detach myself from, and I clear my mind, and I got to a place where I can actually utilize the power that's in me, the subconscious power, and with that I'm able to make observations, and here's my observations, and here's my experience. You can do the same, right? So Buddhism is a science in that way. It's a science that is based on experience. That's all. That's really why I want to do this episode. So how am I going to do that? Well, what I want to do is first explain modern science, but do it in a way that is through a movie. And many of you know this movie called Interstellar, very popular blockbuster movie in 2016. So I'm going to talk a little bit about that movie, and then I'm going to talk about how that movie has to do with science, modern science. And then I'm going to talk about some of the observations through this movie that are based on modern science and how it actually has relevance in what Buddhists have taught, what Buddha has taught, okay? So first about the movie. The movie is about intergalactic traveling between stars, right? So of course in some ways it's a very typical story. It starts with planet Earth dying because humans have exploited. Stephen Hawking, Professor Hawking, had predicted that. He thinks that that's what happened in 1,000 years anyway. Of course, the movie kind of accelerated that and talks about in modern time. But the point is that the movie starts with planet Earth no longer able to sustain itself. The plant lives are dying. People are dying of diseases. And the only way out is to leave the planet to go to find a new colony. And the whole point of the movie is that it is possible, right? Because the next planet, we don't know of any other planet within our reach that is suitable for life. But the point of the movie is that it does exist. It actually exists millions of light years ago. But how do you get there, right? Millions of light years means that if you were traveling at the speed of light, it would still take a million years, let alone traveling at the speed that is humanly possible. So you can never get there on a conventional level. And so, of course, the movie talks about traveling in space, and it talks about something called a wormhole. A wormhole is essentially a pathway between two regions of space. So typically, a wormhole is explained like this. First, you have to accept the idea that we don't live in a three-dimensional space. We can experience a three-dimensional space, but the space that we exist is actually five-dimensional, so there's time and gravity. And so if you think of our own projection on that three-dimensional space, it's as if you just look at a two-dimensional region. And if you think of this as like a ribbon that we can imagine, instead of human beings where we can go anywhere we want, upstairs, downstairs, you're just an ant, and your ant kind of live on this flat land. And of course, if you want to go from one end of the flat land to another, it would take you millions of lifetime. Can't do that. And what the scientist says is that, but on the other hand, there is the possibility of a wormhole. A wormhole is the nickname given to the idea that if you take an apple and you have a little ant that is on top of the apple and you want to get to the bottom, you will have to travel a very long distance. But unless there's actually a hole through that apple created by a worm, and in which case you can take a shortcut and you can then quickly go from one end to the other. So a wormhole in space is the same idea in that, again, projecting on a two-dimensional ribbon. What if the ribbon were wrapped to yourself and there is a way to get from one end of the ribbon to another through a something called a wormhole? And if you can travel through the wormhole, then sure enough, you can go from, you can find a colony very far away. And then that wormhole would take you there within a lifetime. Interesting, right? And then the movie goes on and says not only did they find a new planet, they were able to move the entire population, remaining population of Earth, by finding a way to work with gravity, not against, and escape the planet and then get there. That's the movie. Well, you would say, okay, so that's the movie. What's so big about that? Lots of movies talks about science fiction like that. This one is different. This one actually is written, co-written, and co-produced by a very famous scientist by the name of Dr. Kip Thorne, who had recently retired from Caltech. Dr. Thorne was born in 1940, so today he's about 76 years old. And he was actually known as the youngest professor ever got tenure at Caltech. So at the age of 25, he received his PhD. He only spent about 5 years between bachelor and PhD, which is at least twice as fast as what most people can do. But at the age of 27, he was already a tenure professor at Caltech, the youngest tenure professor ever at Caltech. And at the age of 30, he was a full professor. He then became the very famous, prominent chair professor, Feynman chair at Caltech. He retired about 7 years ago, 8 years ago, and his newest hobby is making movies. So he actually got together with famous directors and producers at Hollywood And they went out and made this movie with the conditions that everything that's expressed in this movie has to be based on science. And Dr. Thorne is actually responsible for doing all the computer simulations that gives rise to the traveling, the black hole, all the phenomena that you see, including what's called time dilation. I'll talk about that in a minute. Dr. Thorne have supervised 50 PhD students. All of them now are very famous in the field. Dr. Thorne is an expert, a renowned expert in gravitational physics and astrophysics. He, in fact, was responsible for, just last year, they finally were able to measure gravitational wave, which was predicted many years ago. So the gravitational wave not only verified the existence of the black hole, but verified a lot more detail. So let's talk about some of the things that was observed in the movie, and then now talk about how it relates to what we know in Buddhism. So one of the things that is really interesting to me is what's called time dilation. And time dilation means that, and you probably know this story where recently they did a study of the twins, a set of twins, both are astronauts, but one actually did some space traveling and one stayed behind. And the one that did space traveling actually turns out to age faster than the one who stayed behind. So if you want, you can go to YouTube and actually dig up a lot of really interesting and very accessible explanation by Dr. Thorne about time dilation, time traveling, black holes, and so forth. And one of the things that strikes me is that the difference between what Einstein talks about and what Isaac Newton talks about. When we study gravitational force, we think of gravitation as a force, and it's the force that pulls two mass together. The fact that I'm sitting here, there's a force that pulls me towards the Earth, otherwise I'll be floating. That's called gravitational force. The fact that Moon is spinning around the Earth is spinning around the Sun, and together they form a galaxy. That all has to do with gravitational force, which is a force exists between two mass. Dr. Thorne explained it a little differently because based on Einstein's observation, it isn't so much that gravitation is a force, it is that there's in the presence of mass, so if you're sitting on Earth, your time is different than if you're sitting on someplace else, on the Moon or in the space. So in this case, the clock is actually slower on Earth than it is on outer space. So if you have the two twins, one is on Earth and one is outer space, the clock is actually slower on Earth than it is traveling space. So that's why the one is traveling is ages faster. And nature has a way of moving towards a place where time is traveling slower. That explains why if you have two masses, the mass actually warps time. And so if you have Earth and Moon, then what it says is that the clock is actually slower on Earth than it is on the Moon, and therefore the Moon is attracted to Earth. I find that very interesting. All right, so then a black hole is basically a region where time is slower. And the black hole actually has a singularity. So because it is a region where time is slower, it attracts planets. And as planets comes into the mass, they collapse, and then now makes time even bigger. Mass makes time even slower, and it attracts more mass. And ultimately, there's a singularity where time stands still, and mass actually no longer exists at that singularity, which is very interesting, right? It says that. If you think of a body consists of mass, and the fact that it makes us a human being means that we also have a conscience. Conscience is energy, okay? And as you develop, as a human develop, to the point that they become aware, as in Buddha, he can actually live in a region of space where it doesn't age. Interesting, right? So in the movie, it talks about the Miller's planet. The Miller's planet is one of the planets that the main character, the astronaut, has to go and investigate. The Miller's planet happened to be the first planet that is orbiting around a gigantic black hole, a black hole called Gargantua. Gargantua is actually 100 million times the mass of Sun. So it's a huge black hole. It's a huge black hole. And the fact that it totally distorts time, right? So the fact that Miller planet is so close to the black hole, every minute, every hour that you spend on planet Earth is actually 7 years on Earth. And so the movie talks about how the main character were on the surface of a planet, and he was only there like for 3 hours. And by the time he get back to the space station, which was outside the regions where outside the influence of the black hole, his colleague, who was the same age as he was, which was a young man, had already aged to a point that he was middle age. And in fact, the movie talks about how he continues to travel in space, continues to go in and out of the black hole and so forth. And by the time he came back to Earth, or by the time he saw his daughter again, whom he left when she was only a teenager, she was already a dying old person. Time dilation is basically talks about how within the space, within what we know as the outer space, there are regions where, especially the regions where there's strong gravitational forces, time is slower. Now, we talk a great deal about that in Buddhism. Actually, there are sutras that you can go to that talks about what exists outside of where the humans, so we consider this world that we live in, we're humans. And in fact, in Buddhist teaching, it talks a great deal about the three different realms. The one that we live in is called the Kama Kama Dhatu, right? That's the realm of desire. Right, and the reason that we live here as a human being, totally consumed by our material existence, is because we have very strong desire. And if you could practice and meditate, you will slowly eliminate that sense of material desire, and you become a very refined being, such as Buddha. And then you will slowly move away from this realm called the Kama Dhatu. And the next one that you go to is called the Rupa Dhatu, where you're not possessed anymore with just desire, but you still are. You still have the presence. You still have the body. And then the one beyond that is called Arupa. A means not. So no more need for material form. And so those three are the realms where the different sentient beings would exist. And of course, we're still living on Earth, right? The Kama, part of the Kama Dhatu. And then above that is a region where you can call it heaven, but it's not, it doesn't have the same meaning as heaven in Christianity. But basically there's six levels of heaven right above us. And in the sutta they talk a great deal about how time is different. For example, the first one, which I can translate into English, called the Four Heavenly Kings Realm, every day is equivalent to 50 years. And then the next one, and so forth. And 1 hour on planet Earth is 7 years. One hour on planet Miller is 7 years on Earth. So every 24 hours is 168 years. So if you spend a day on Miller's planet, that's about 168 years on planet. So that would exist somewhere between the second and the third level. Okay. The next thing that they talk about in the movie, again, is based on modern science, is how you could actually travel back in time. And this is a key part of the story, in that the main character has to travel back in time in order to communicate with his young daughter, so that his young daughter can grow up to be a scientist who then solves the problem that allows them to escape the planet Earth. And so in the movie, it talks about this cubic space that someone else have created, some intelligent being has created for him, that allows him to take the four-dimensional space, which is the three dimension that we live in, plus time, and just travel back in time. And as he traveled back in time, he was able to see his daughter. He was only able to look through the bookshelf in his daughter's bedroom. And as he traveled in time, he was able to see his daughter as a young adult to a teenager, and then ultimately to a young daughter, the young daughter that he left behind. Now, in Buddhism, we talk about that. We actually talk about that as a person meditate, the first step is what we call samadhi, which is to kind of calm yourself, so that you can kind of remove yourself from the daily life disturbance and so forth, and you become very calm and very calm, and then slowly you go from samadhi to the insight, where you start to observe your mind, and as you do that, you actually then tap into a lot of ability that is in the subconscious level. And in the Buddhist literature, they talk about the six different things that would occur. And in English, this translates into supernormal knowledge, right? And so the first one is that you can walk on water, right? You can walk on water. Don't ask me to explain it, but it's in the literature, right? Jesus Christ walked on water. Jesus Christ is obviously a very well-developed being, highly aware of his own conscience. And the other person that talks about how you walk on water is Bodhidharma, a North Indian monk that came to China, that eventually became the founding master of the Chan Buddhism, the Chan meditation technique, and also became the inventor of what is now known as the Shaolin martial art. And big story about how he was able to float and just cross the river on a straw. Okay, walk on water. Then the next step is clairvoyance, telepathy, and it comes to the part where you can recall past life. You can actually look at a person and be able to tell what he did in his past lives. You say, well, how is that possible? How is that possible? In the movie, they talk about that it is possible. So last time we talked about karma and magnetism, and I talk about karma as a force, as a record, right? That if you, when you have a mental volition, the mental volition is electricity. Electricity causes a disturbance on the time-space continuum. And even after the thought, electricity leaves behind an imprint. It leaves behind magnetism. The magnetism is karma. So karma is a record of all the thoughts that you have, all the mental actions that you have, but it's more than that. It's also a hidden force, it's a dormant force. So the next time when you have a thought, then the karma comes into play, right? That's why we always react the same way. I mean, people typically react the same way because they have all this karmic energy that defines who they are. And so, of course, we can't see it. We can't see it. We don't have the ability to see it. But just because you can't see it doesn't mean it doesn't exist. And if it exists, that means someone else can see it. And so in the Buddhist literature, they talk about how as you become aware, this is one of your ability that you can actually sense the karmic force. And so with that, you can tell what the person have done in the past. That's how we looked into the past life. In the movies, they do that. It's part of, it's predicted by modern science, that you can actually go back and look at the past life, time travel. So, for what it's worth, I find it fascinating. I find it fascinating that a movie that serves as a vehicle for us to understand modern science actually talks about some of the stuff that we have to study in Buddhism. The difference is, Buddhism is not based on observation. Modern science is based on observation. Buddhism is about experience. All Buddha did, Buddha is a human, right? He's not a god. He's not any kind of divine feature. He's a human. He's just like Einstein or Newton. He's just another scientist. And basically he says, okay, well, here's how I do it. And if you follow these paths, you would experience that. And many people do. I experienced something. I haven't experienced everything, obviously. But I'm confident that as I continue my practice, I will experience some of that. What does that have to do with what we're doing here? All I'm proposing is that if you really want to embrace your life, that you want to find a better way to live, best way to live, then you need to open up your horizon. You need to be open-minded. And you need to treat science as a science, but you also need to treat Buddhism as a science. Okay? And only then you get to explore your body beyond just what's the material. You can actually tap into your mental power. What is underneath? Okay, and I believe that will allow you to live more fully. That's all. I hope you enjoyed this. We'll see you next time. Thank you. Bye bye.